world to mark the golden 100 years celebration of this very well-known institute. I'm also thankful to him for giving me an opportunity to expose myself to the requirement of the nutritionists in terms of food, fruits, and other commodities. I've been associated with production of fruits and vegetables for the last 5 decades, and my talk is going to be around that. I think much of the information which I had collected to present, a part of it has been presented by one person or the other, making my job simpler. But despite the fact, I have a couple of slides which I would like to pass through, and in case I feel that the information has already been presented, I'll just pass through and give a very, very brief reference to that. Now, as far as the talk is concerned, the title assigned to me was Importance of Fruits and Vegetables in Food Systems. When we think of food systems, particularly in India, they have been actually guided by the ground realities. When there was partition in 1947, our major problem was hunger. We started producing more of cereals. At the Green Revolution, tried to meet that requirement. We also found that our requirement was in milk. There was a milk revolution because of the efforts of certain individuals. Then we started laying our emphasis on oil seeds and pulses. We have done extremely well in pulses and also in oil seeds. And with the coming of oil palm, with the good and bad advantages which it has, I think we are going to solve very soon the oil situation in the country. And then simultaneously, the fruits and vegetables came. When I was a student of horticulture, there was no fruit and vegetable worth to be seen in the markets. But when I'm about to, after retirement, every street has several shops of fruits and vegetables, and also of flowers, which we are not talking about here. Now I am giving a holistic presentation of how it happened. And as I said, whatever has already been said, I'll try to exclude. We are talking of food systems, and many definitions have been given of the food systems. I would only restrict to the central definition, which is given by the FAO in 2018. The food systems comprise all food products that originate from crop and livestock production, forestry, fisheries and agriculture, aquaculture, as well as the broader economic, societal and natural environments in which these derived production systems are embedded. Now the much of these 3-4 slides which I'm going to show have been shown. Prevalence of hunger, I don't think you need to be thought about it, but some of the figures might help us to correlate with the next slides. Global production of food grain, I've indicated to you, 284.87 million tons, 815 million people to feed. Vast majority is hungry people, and they are in developing countries. Most hungry people live in Asia, and then slight increase in Western Asia. In sub-Saharan region, 1 out of 4 is undernourished, 2.1 billion people overweight and obese, and lack of adequate food. Now the prevalence of hunger in India, we feel that the hunger has been taken care of in India, but the latest, only a few weeks back, the hunger index which has been indicated puts India into 103rd place out of 118 countries. You can see that still nutrition is far from us. We are still very hungry, and I think the first objective for India has to be to meet this hunger situation. 3 billion people are affected from the micronutrient deficiencies, and there is a effect of hunger, malnutrition and micronutrient deficiency is there, that 40 poor nutrition causes 45% of deaths in children under 5 years of age. According to Global Burden of Disease study, 3.4 million deaths are attributed to low consumption of fruits and 1.8 million to low consumption of vegetables. I think this is the type of things which need to be taken up in the future research programs in the nutritional system. Low intake of fruits and vegetables is among the top 10 risk factors for mortality in the world, resulting in 14% of deaths due to gastrointestinal cancer, 11% due to ischemic heart, 9% due to stroke, 1.7 million, that is 2.58% are the total death because of them. Now in the food system, there has been a changing pattern of food consumption. I think our food system has been basically, you know, tuned to eating only cereals and all that. And I've indicated to you how the situation in the country has changed. But the pattern and quantum of food by population has been changing very fast, as has been indicated, because of urbanization, because of high and low incomes and other requirements. With the time, focus is changing from food security to nutritional security, addressing food energy deficiency and micronutrient malnutrition. Increasing urbanization has been leading to a change in dietary pattern from food grains to fruits and vegetables. Changes in dietary pattern have been creating a pressure on our natural resources, and with growing population, the strategy of food security has been focused on increasing and expanding agricultural production, which is no more unlimited. Everybody has talked about the global population. I'm also indicating that by 2050, we would have about 10 billion people. But what is the consequence of this increase? The land resources are also decreasing, and you have seen how per capita land is decreasing to about a very, very small amount is now, you know, available per capita, which is little over than 0.2%. Drinking water resources have been talked about, and India and China use about 20% of their internal renewable freshwater resources for agriculture besides their country. The global climate change, there have been full presentation, rise in global surface temperature, extent of snow cover is decreasing, shift in occurrence of extreme events like floods, drought, frost, disease and pest, and increased greenhouse emissions, about which we have talked in detail. So a situation has come, and the greater emphasis has to be in the food systems on horticultural crops. India needs 333 million metric ton grain production to meet demand by 2050, for its estimated 1.7 billion people. But the above challenges require greater emphasis on horticultural crop production to meet the future food and nutritional requirement of hungry, malnutrition, and rising population. There are three challenges before us. Fruits and vegetables in the food system provide a variety of color, flavor, texture besides nutrition, and you know what nutrients they provide: dietary fibers, essential vitamins, minerals, vegetable proteins. But lately, major emphasis is also being laid on the contribution of phytochemicals with increasing role in health management. The recommended intakes are known to all of you. I will not go to them. But now let us talk of the availability of fruits and vegetables. And we have already talked about their importance. I think per capita consumption of fruits and vegetables falls short of the daily requirement levels. But to talk of the minor vegetable or ethnic crops, as you know, biodiversity exploitation, I think even the major crops, we are not yet sufficient in our production of fruits and vegetables for the growing population. Intake generally is in the range of 20 to 50% of the minimum recommended level, and this is attributed to unhealthy diets in overdeveloped countries and poverty and food security in developing countries. Now, the changing consumption of pattern has been indicated between 1983 and 2011 in the following. You see, the vegetables, there has been an increase of 17.3% in the Indian diets per person. In fruits, there has been an increase of 260%. And look at cereals, a decrease of 20%. Pulses, a decrease of 15%. Sugar, decrease of 12%. Edible oil, increase of 78%. Milk, increase of 44%. And meat, fish and egg, increase. So I think we have to see the changing pattern, how our government policies are affecting the food availability in the country, and then accordingly we have to devise our food systems. Much has been done on the analysis of fruits and vegetables. And I think a lot of tables have been published in various forms. But that's all I would like to say. When we talk of variability in the tables, I must tell you that there is a large variety of genetic material available in the country, and there is so much of variation, even in the essential nutrients or micronutrients or fiber in them, that any value will not stand. So I think we have to start talking of averages or the range rather than giving a definite value to any particular fruits and vegetables. I've briefly given, which I'll just pass through, carbohydrates, major fruits, out of, and then major vegetables, which have been studied, and I've tried to group them here in different categories. Proteins, you see cashew, almond, walnuts, the nuts are the major sources. Same is true for fats, dietary fibers. Then vitamins, I've indicated, most of you know, I will not go into these details. High nutritive fruits and vegetable minerals, they have also been tried to be indicated, which are required to be used in our food system. But one of the important facts which has been reported recently is the role of color in fruits and vegetables in human health. We have a number of colors, and there have been 7 categorizations of color for food in fruits and vegetables. And it has been indicated that each has a different effect because of the different constituents which are available in that. White brown color contains sulforaphanes. Purple blue color contains anthocyanins. Orange yellow color contains carotenoids. Green color contains a range of phytochemicals. Red color contains lycopene and antioxidant. So each color has some indication to offer to you so that the use of that particular crops and varieties would be accordingly tailored. We talk of horticulture for we talk of nutrition, but I'll say horticulture remedy for nutritional malady. There are several maladies these days for which horticulture can become a permanent remedy if given in adequate quantities and with the choice also being relevant. I've indicated nutritional malady proteins, then some crops, broccoli, spinach. If calcium is deficient, what to do? If iron is there, what to do? Vitamin A, asparagus, cabbage, carrot, thiamine, green leafy vegetables, riboflavin, mushrooms, niacin, asparagus, vitamin C, of course, all the crops are known. Total foliate, again, broccoli, lettuce, prefolic acid, dark leafy vegetables. Then a stage has come where we are going beyond nutrition. The fruits and vegetables are now being explored for protection against diseases, and I think that's going to be a major line of approach in years to come. And I've indicated here what has been reported to be this based on the research reports, but I've tried to sum them up. Anemia, kiwi fruit which has come from New Zealand and is making inroads into our system is very, very useful. Cardiovascular diseases, avocado, blueberries, citrus fruits, etc. Blood pressure, kiwi and citrus. Diabetes, amla, kiwi, even jaman. Obesity, fiber-rich fruits and vegetables. Cancer, pomegranate, tomato-based products, leafy vegetables, garlic, brassica vegetables, and many more are there. So I think on the next column also, liver diseases, amla and apple, sleeping disorder, again kiwi, skin diseases, amla, jaundice, kidney stones. So there are a lot of fruits which can be exploited scientifically and systematically to cure these diseases which are now becoming very common these days. Now the global availability of fruits and vegetables I've given in the next slide, and you will see that the global availability has been increasing from 1961, but then it has still to increase by 2050. It is felt that while the food production itself has to increase by 70% to meet our requirements of hungry people by 2050, keeping in view the population. So I think we have a lot to do even with food, but to talk of the nutrients. The world food and vegetable production, you would see, has already reached the increased 4 times and 5 times respectively in the last about 4 or 5 decades. We had a, normally we feel most of the fruits and vegetables are coming from America, Australia, and you know, Europe. You see the table, the circle above here, 69% of the fruits and vegetables are being produced in Asia. So that is the source they are going to other countries per se. I don't think we are really deficient in them. We are, I mean, less used. As far as India is concerned, we started virtually from zero as far as fruits and vegetables are concerned. But I am very happy to say that during the last 6 years, we have already exceeded food production in the country by vegetable and fruit production. So the question has come, increasing role of these in the changing systems has to be now there in our entire program. You will see that the fruit production last year was 283.5 million tons, whereas the food production was 252.685 million tons. Now we have to take care of the demand and supply projection in the country, and I have tried to show up to 230, you will see that as far as vegetables are concerned, in spite of our all what we are doing, we'll be having a shortage of 32.0 million tons. And as far as fruits are concerned, we will have a shortage of 9.9 million tons. Then what are we doing to improve the availability of fruits and vegetables? It's more of an agriculture, but I think being nutritionist, you need to know what the government policies stand for when it comes to fruit and vegetable production. I think one of the first things is when there is no land, we need to have a suitable land use. I don't think the time has come when we can experiment more with those crops which are neither sustainable, they are not income giving, because already our holdings are very small and we have to look for crops which can sustain the farmer's income. So I think anything you look for, even from the biodiversity angle, must be sustainable to the farmers besides being useful for nutrition in years to come. And then we have to lay emphasis on the crop suited to the area. That's where we meet the needs. Emphasis on unexploited crops. We had 2-3 player representation. Identification of new clusters for production. Promoting year-round vegetable production. Inter and mixed cropping. Integrated farming system. Reclamation of wasteland. For years together, there has been a wasteland authority. But I don't think significant efforts have been made to use these wastelands. And they are very good for dry region fruits, for medicinal and aromatic plants, and several other crops. Then the law I've indicated here, turning wastelands into production areas, and that's where your crops like fig, jackfruit, pear, jamun, karonda, those are the crops in the wasteland area. We have been trying also to introduce nutritionally important and also important from the point of view of income, fruits from other countries. I'm very happy to say that we had success in that. Kiwi was introduced from New Zealand. Similarly, passion fruit was uncommon fruit. We have again made it a commercial success. Then kokum in the Western Ghat has become very, very important fruit in Maharashtra. Then if you see the Sibakthar in the Lahore Valley is now coming up on a very large scale. Isle palm, which was a Malaysian isle-bearing plant, is now virtually planted on 2 lakh hectares in the country. And then gherkins, we never knew beyond our cucumber. So gherkin becoming very common in the country. Baby corn, we were only knowing of the cobs. And then broccoli, cherry, tomato, drumstick. So the point I'm making is, we are not averse to adapting new crops. And if there is any new crop found out in years to come, I think there is a potential of commercially cultivating it and making it available. And emphasis on less exploited fruit. So many people have been talking, but we have made an analysis of what is available and what is potential. And we have seen that the following 8 fruits have a potential to be exploited in the country. And in case they have a potential to be exploited for nutritional purposes, I think it will be a 2-in-1. And these are, as I have indicated about jamun, I have indicated about avocado, bale fruit not fully exploited. So like that, there are a number of crops which can be exploited in years to come. Then again, another few unexploited crops. You see the dragon fruit, which has virtually no sugar, and for obese people, it's very good. Besides, many other fruits I've given, makhana, palmyra palm, and similarly jamun, and other. What is there to show? I won't talk of enhancing productivity, but what we are doing, I will go ahead. These are the newer systems. Promoting alternate horticulture systems. We have been talking of peri-urban horticulture to produce more. We have been talking of protected cultivation. We have many micro-greens and polyhouses, which can be harvested only in a week or 10 days, and then have rotation and keep on feeding the people. We have the hydroponics, we have the aeroponics, we have the, you know, I think a lot of new things are happening which I want. Then promoting safe and healthy foods has been talked about. I would not talk about them, but then emphasis on safe horticulture is very, very important. Otherwise, we'll be undoing what nutrition is. Well, with these remarks, I'll come to the last slide. Aiming from post-harvest losses have been indicated to increase our production and availability, and I have indicated the role of modern practices in doing that. Exploring horticultural wealth through nutrition, already this slide has been shown by Dr. Dhaliwal, and then the next slide by Dr. Kalia. And I think these are the four people who got the last year World Food Prize for biofortification in sweet potato. And then current data is already shown in two talks. Genetically modified fruits, which have a mixed reaction in various countries. The way forward. Last slide, improving production, productivity, and availability of fruits and vegetables. Promoting intake to avoid malnutrition and improving healthy health of population. Adoption of healthy heating habits. Capacity building for obtaining healthy and safe produce and products. Increasing exploitation of fruits and vegetables for antioxidants, pigments, healthy oils, phytochemicals, biofortification, nutraceuticals, pharmaceuticals. Improving emphasis on urban and peri-urban horticulture and fruits